In this panel, we will be discussing how to build an effective movement by examining the strategies of a prominent movement today, BDS, Boycott, Divestment, Sanction. So as Alice already said, I'm really honored to have Lucas Febraro here with us today. Lucas is an activist, writer, and content creator born in Brazil, who has worked with organizations such as DiEM25 and the Palestinian National Committee. So today we will discuss the origins of the BDS movement, its demands and targets, and how to get involved in the movement. So starting with the origins of the movement, boycotts played a crucial role in both the anti-apartheid movement in South Africa and the civil rights movement in the United States as a form of nonviolent resistance. In the anti-apartheid movement, boycotts were vital in isolating the apartheid regime and weakening its economic foundation. In the civil rights movement, for example, the Montgomery bus boycott, were one of the most effective strategies to challenge segregation and racial injustice. Lucas, could you tell us how BDS drew its inspiration from these movements?
Sure. First of all, thanks, Aya. Thanks for the invitation. Thanks to everyone for being here. Just as a tiny correction, I've worked with the Palestinian BDS National Committee, there are other organizations that also go by the name BDS, for Palestinian National Committee, which is the central coordinating body of the BDS movement. Is a coalition, the broadest coalition ever assembled in Palestinian civil society. And it was that coalition that issued the original call for BDS in 2005. But to go to your question, it drew inspiration from it in the sense that a lot of what BDS does today, the Palestinian BDS, was very similar, pretty much exactly the same, to what the grassroots movement to boycott apartheid South Africa and divest from it and sanction it did decades ago. And it drew inspiration from it because it worked. It worked tremendously well. It forced a lot of companies to end operations in apartheid South Africa. It forced a lot of funds and other corporations and universities to divest from those companies. And from any sort of business at all with apartheid South Africa. Some of the same universities, especially in the US, where you see today students calling for their universities to divest from apartheid Israel. And it worked in the sense that states around the world actually finally brought sanctions upon the apartheid regime. That was tremendously important. It was the only factor, but it was tremendously important in bringing down the apartheid regime and freeing the indigenous population in South Africa. It proved to be outside of South Africa the best way to spend your time if you wanted to be an ally to the cause, essentially. Of course, there are elements. There was the struggle inside of South Africa, the indigenous people there, just as that exists today in Palestine as well. But when you look at it from the perspectives of people outside and what we can do, especially people who are in some of the states that are the most implicit in supporting these human rights violations in both cases, that proved to be the most effective method, and today it remains the most effective method, I think.
And I think what it teaches us as well is that it's not that all of a sudden the oppressor feels bad for the people that they're oppressing and has a change of heart, but that it needs to hurt them financially and economically in order for things to change. So if we move a bit forward in time, after the verdict of the ICJ in 2004 about the illegality of the apartheid law, the BDS movement started, and this brought together 170 organizations in the Palestinian civil society, consisting among trade unions, refugee organizations, and women collectives. So as these 170 organizations met, could you tell us what consensus they came to in terms of what their demands are?
So there are three basic demands. And as a matter of fact, if anyone here hasn't read the original BDS call that was issued in 2005, I encourage you to do that. It's extremely short. It's like half a page long. You can do it in 2 minutes. And it's very enlightening. And there you see those basic demands, which were the demands in 2005 and remain the basic demands now. So if you look at the Palestinian people, there are three main groups. There are, of course, it's a lot more complex than that, but in very basic terms, there is the Palestinians living inside of the 1948 borders of Israel. Many of whom are citizens of the city of Israel, but not the quality, which we'll get to in a second. There is the people living under Israeli occupation outside of those broad borders, but within Palestine, so in the West Bank and Gaza. And there are the Palestinian refugees who are not in Palestine anymore, and their descendants, the Palestinian diaspora. So there are three basic demands. Each one, one for each, pertaining to each of those groups, essentially. So the first one is full equality for Palestinians living within the 1948 borders of Israel, because they also live under a system of apartheid, because Israel is essentially a Jewish ethnostate, in which Jewish supremacy is enforced both in the law and in fact. So the first demand is for that system to end and for Palestinians within those borders and for the plot. The second demand is, of course, for the occupation to end, the illegal occupation that is over several decades long, both in the West Bank and in Gaza, for that to end. And then the third is for the Palestinian refugees to have their right exercised to return to their homes, the properties that were expelled from during the Nakba, and of course the ongoing Nakba that goes on to this day. So for them to be able to do that and receive full reparations. All of those three demands are enshrined in international law. These are not demands that the BDS movement dreamt up, or that the Palestinians more broadly dreamt up. These are extremely well established in international law and resolutions for the UN Security Council, from the UN General Assembly, and from the ICJ. So these are not nice asks, these are not charitable asks. These are just the demands that international law be finally implemented and that Israel's impunity and oppression of Palestinians end.
I think that's crucial to mention, because it is indeed the bare minimum to have equal rights, to have a right of return. This is the absolute bare minimum of also why so many people, 170 civil organizations, came together to agree to these demands. And what I like is that BDS is very pragmatic. It has three clear demands, but there is also a very clear framework that was set up: boycott, divestment, and sanction. Could you tell us what these three pillars entail?
Sure. Also, just a small note, you mentioned 170 organizations, 170 coalitions. So just for to give a sense of the scope of the what we call the BNC, which is the Palestinian BDS National Committee. The entirety of the Palestinian civil society is incorporated there. Back to your question. Boycott is pretty self-explanatory. Basically, especially consumer boycotts. So these are, especially people are on social media these days, they're very familiar with false boycotts companies. These are not always, the list of companies that are targeted by the BDS movements, which I'm sure we'll get to later on. But that's the idea, basically, to build campaigns for consumers to boycott companies, and also for customers, especially if it's a company that provides services, for their customers to pressure these companies directly, not only boycott them, but also tell them why they're boycotting them, which is an important part. And to do that collectively, so not individually in a sort of like choose with your wallet type of way. You just go to the supermarket and you choose not to buy from this company anymore. That's all fine and good, of course. But the idea is to do more than that, because that in 99% of the cases is just simply not enough. So to really get together, organize, to build pressure in front of company headquarters, company events, disrupt company events, and all that. That's the boycott part. I'll go to sections and then to sanctions, and then I'll go back to the investment. Sanctions is also pretty easy to understand. It's to pressure states to impose sanctions on Israel, which they have the obligation to do. It's not a charitable ask. They have the obligation to impose sanctions on Israel because of the rulings by the ICJ. One of the missions that originated the call was in 2004. There have been subsequent ones. As a matter of fact, there was one just in July that essentially stopped a little bit short, but basically spelled out that Israel is an apartheid state, which was the first. And again, reiterated that states have the obligation to review their relations with Israel in order to make sure that they're not aiding Israel in sustaining the illegal status quo of its occupation. The thing is, for Israel, everything that it controls is Israeli territory. It makes no distinction between occupied territory and the 1948 borders, which are the internationally accepted borders of Israel. Because that distinction that it doesn't exist, basically every company that's worth mentioning that operates in Israel, from Israeli companies, they are complicit in some sort of way in the occupation. States have the obligation to review all of their ties with Israel, because there is no such thing as just analyzing the companies that operate in the occupied territories. They have the obligation to do that, especially when it comes to a military embargo, which is, of course, the most direct way of being complicit in Israel's violation of Palestinian rights and international law. So that's the sanctions part. You have divestment. Divestment is usually the one that is a little bit harder for people to understand, because it's a bit of a step removed. You boycott a company directly, but to divest from a company, for most of us at least, that's not something that we can do directly. So we have to pressure institutions in which we are stakeholders or part of in some way, like universities, like pension funds, to do that divestment. That's really, really important, really crucial, because especially when you talk about, again, the companies that are the most complicit, which are, say, the arms dealers, for example, or companies that do surveillance. Divestment is really the only way in which you can get to them, because no one is going to supermarket buying missiles. That's really crucial. And that's why the movements the students' movements to divest in places such as the UK, in the US, Australia, I'm mentioning those because in those countries, universities act as corporations. They have a huge pile of money that can be just like a staggering amount of money. Universities like Harvard, like Stanford, like Columbia, well in the dozens of billions of dollars, and they just like they invest in companies. They act like corporations. So it's extremely important to pressure them to divest, just as was done with apartheid in South Africa successfully in many cases. And it's been successfully now as well. Not yet with the biggest universities, but with a lot of them. And again, pension funds, sovereign funds as well, to pressure them all to divest. That's extremely important. So I think that has been so much in the face of all of the sheer horror that we've been witnessing for the past year. There have been so many positive things happening in terms of BDS successes. And I think the heightened awareness that people have in the successes in divestment are among the most important.
And I wanted to pick up about what you said about boycotts, because I think this is very practical for all of us in this room. I think we all feel a new sense of commitment that we do not want to purchase products that are complicit, right? We don't want to support them at all. And so we use the No Thanks app, for example, and that includes hundreds of companies that we should boycott. But the BDS list is much shorter. So could you explain to us why that is and what the power behind targeted boycotts is?
Sure, and that's really a really key element, because especially nowadays, fortunately, you don't see that so much anymore, but in the early days of the genocide, you saw on social media a lot of lists being spread with sometimes literally hundreds of companies, just hundreds of companies, without any sort of explanation as to like who picked these, why, what are the criteria that they use. It's all, at the same time, you don't want to be too critical, because the impulse to engage in BDS is very positive. But we have to make sure that this is done in a targeted way, just because, first of all, there is a matter of credibility, because you have to be very selective. You have to have a criteria that makes a company a potential target for BDS, and you have to make that explicit, so that companies know also what they can do not to link themselves on that list, not be complicit. But there's also the element of strategy. You cannot target 200 companies at the same time. It just doesn't work like that. You have to bring a critical mass of people, be it in a country, in a continent, or around the world, to bear down on just a few targets. Because otherwise, there's only so much people power that we have, and you have to work within those limitations. So that's essentially the key thing to remember here, and that's why we need to keep these lists quite short, and that's why I think everyone should look first and foremost to what companies the Palestinian BDS National Committee is targeting around the world, and see if you can engage in one or some of those campaigns where you live. If for whatever reason you can't, because the companies that are being targeted are not active where you live, or you just want to go beyond that, that's fine. But it's very important that we keep this priority list of targets, and that we look to it first and foremost.
And Lucas, you mentioned that there's a criteria applied in order to decide which targets make it to the BDS list. Could you tell us a bit more about what the criteria is that is used to define those targets?
Sure. It's really quite simple. There's three main elements. And by the way, this is all that I'm saying to you, every word so far is not any type of inside information. You can go to this BDS website and you can see all this for yourself as well. But there are three main criteria. The first one is the level of complicity, which is obviously a no-brainer. How complicit is this company complicit in the Israel's oppression of Palestinians, or is it not? And if it is, how complicit is it? That's the first one. The second one is the potential to build coalitions, because BDS works with partners around the world. It doesn't do everything by itself, not by a long shot. So there are the direct BDS partners, the ones that even use the name BDS in several countries. We have some in Germany here, of course, and in Berlin specifically. But also beyond that, there are partners that do other things that go beyond BDS that are also BDS partners in different countries. If you look at a company, for example, a lot of these companies, they're not, Palestine is not the only place where they're committing crimes and where they're violating human rights. So is there a campaign already happening against this company somewhere that has gathered some steam, you have to look into that. What's the potential for a coalition building, which goes into the last element, which is the potential for success. Symbolic wins are all fine and good, but usually when a company is being targeted by BDS, there is an ask for it to end this complicity, and they will not stop being targeted until that demand is comes to fruition, basically. So you have to ask yourself, what's the potential for that to happen? So these are the three key elements.
Thank you. Thank you for also mentioning that a lot of the companies on the BDS list are actually complicit in many other oppressive regimes. And as I was looking at the companies who are on the BDS list, one of them is Siemens. And Siemens is actually not only complicit in Palestine, but in seven other oppressive regimes, including Western Sahara and Myanmar, as they provide the technological infrastructure there. So I think this is very powerful for people to be aware of, as then we can build coalitions regarding these companies, as you mentioned. So do you see any other potential that we can build coalitions on these boycott targets?
Yeah, another example is Chevron. Chevron is a boycott target of the BDS movement. It's active in a bunch of different countries. Of course, its biggest market, I'm sure, is the US. It does oil extraction. It also has a consumer-facing side of it, especially with gas stations. That operates under the its own name, the Chevron brand, and also the Texaco brand. So there is a they're also very much complicit in Israel's violations of Palestinian rights and international law, because they are extremely active in doing oil extraction in what should be Palestinian resources, essentially, that enrich Israel and make things, commitments such as committing genocide possible. So Chevron is a target, but if you look at Chevron, obviously it doesn't stop there. You know, like Chevron is so, like Chevron is, you know, just it's a stain on the face of planet Earth. It just literally is so complicit on so many other crimes throughout its, you know, notorious history, and to this day, there is the climate type things. There is the violation of indigenous people's rights, well beyond Palestine as well. So there is a huge potential to create a coalition to target Chevron. And as a matter of fact, that coalition exists. You know, whenever there's the action against Chevron. It's always, pretty much always, something that is coordinated not just with BDS and its immediate partners, but also with other climate activists, indigenous rights activists elsewhere and beyond Palestine. BDS is important to, what I'm getting at here is intersectionality is a huge part of BDS. It's at the core of BDS. To really drive home the points that Palestine is not just an issue that's isolated, it's something that's happening in the Middle East. These companies, a lot of them, and the people who fund these companies, and the institutions, the states that fund these companies, they are complicit in all sorts of human rights violations all around the world. Israeli companies have contracts with the United States government to police their borders and kill immigrants there. They have contracts with the European Union to police the Mediterranean, which is the deadliest border in the world, and to steal migrants there. So it's very important to build those networks and to build those coalitions to really make sure that these companies pay not just for what they do in Palestine, but elsewhere. That's, I think, not just an ethical obligation, but also strategically critically important for us to have success.
And now we've spoken about economic boycotts, but Israel also overtly uses culture as a form of propaganda to whitewash or justify its regime of occupation, settler colonialism, and apartheid. So BDS, above the economic boycotts, also calls for cultural and academic boycotts. Can you tell us what those entail?
Yes, that's another thing that was the campaign against the protest of Africa was a direct inspiration as well, because there was a campaign for a huge campaign for a cultural and academic boycott of apartheid South Africa. It's important to understand, first of all, in the academic side, every single Israeli university is complicit in apartheid, in occupation, and in genocide. So it is absolutely valid to target every single one of them with boycotts, to demand for a student in the university in Europe or wherever you might be in the world to demand a university cuts ties, especially now with the ongoing genocide, with those institutions. There is no such thing as an Israeli university that is completely all them. They provide no house to the military. They have contracts with the military. So until those universities end those ties, just as we're talking about companies, the same applies to them. They are legitimate targets for boycotts. But of course, whether you're going to call for a boycott of specific one or the other in a particular context, it's the elements of strategic thinking also as well play here. The same goes with culture, and these are two things that Israel uses all the time to whitewash its crimes. Israel, the land of innovation and of academic excellence, culture. They had these this campaign called Brand Israel, if I'm not mistaken. I'm not quite sure if it's still active, but it was a huge concerted effort to change the image of Israel, being advised by advertising agencies in the US and in Europe to change this image of Israel as a land of bad things happening, the shots being fired, human rights violations, and this positive image of Israel being spread around the world. The culture and academic institutions are complicit, and therefore they are targets of PACP and anti-BDS movement more broadly. And as long as they're doing, if you're an academic or an athlete or a singer, whatever you might be, as long as you're representing the state of Israel abroad, you're a legitimate target for the BDS movement, because BDS doesn't target identity. It's not going to target people just because they are Israeli or because they're Jewish. That's a complete fiction and spread about BDS. However, if you are in a capacity in which you're not speaking for yourself, take Eurovision, for example. That singer, the Israeli singer, she wasn't there just representing herself. She was there representing the state of Israel in the most watched concerts in the world, basically. One of the most watched cultural events, period, in the world. So it's completely legitimate to call for Israel to be excluded from Eurovision, and when that fails, to call for a boycott of the event as a whole. So that's a crucial element of BDS. Of course, we must not forget, yes, boycott of divestment sanctions, but also the Palestinian academic and cultural division.
And that's crucial what you mentioned, that it's not about identity, it's about complicity. And I think that this is often, or actually always, misrepresented in German media, because German media claims that BDS is anti-Semitic, and they say that it's what the Nazis did, right? They claim that BDS is do not buy from Jews. But actually BDS is the opposite from that. It's not about identity, it's about if you are complicit in the Israeli occupation, then you become a boycott target. So why do you think the German media is playing this narrative over and over that BDS is anti-Semitic?
It's the only thing they can do. They don't have another leg to stand on.
They're scared, no? Because it works.
That's the other element as well, is because, Israel and Israel's allies are terrified of the BDS movement. They are terrified of it. They spend, just huge fat amounts of money to lobby in the US, in Europe, to demonize BDS and to try to pass laws against BDS, which they have done so successfully in over 30 US states. Which is just a travesty, because again, this is a movement for the implementation of international law, as enshrined in resolutions throughout the decades now. And the same thing, they're trying to do the same thing with like Germany. There was the infamous 2019 Bundestag declaration against BDS. They can't outright ban BDS. Well, they're trying to get out, but they have so far failed to do so because, again, they don't have a leg to stand on. And so the only thing they can try doing is passing the viewing that is illegal and hope that people will look into it and, you know, and find out that they're full shit. So that was, you know, a lot of people to this day think that that was a wallet, I guess, and the Bundestag that made BDS illegal. It's not at all, it's just a symbolic declaration. I believe it might have, it might even have been initiated by the AfD with memory goes on because of failure. And then because the other parties didn't want to be outdone by the AfD, they joined or something like that. But anyway, to go back to your question, that's the only thing they can do, you know? And they can only vilify it and hope that people won't just like take 2 seconds to look into it for themselves and find out that the BDS has absolutely nothing to do with that. It's an anti-racist movement. It's the opposite of a racist movement. It does not target people based on ideas. Targets them based on publicity. And of course, in Germany, you know, it's a fairly easy thing to do because of this legacy of course that Palestinians had absolutely nothing to do of Nazism and of genocides in Germany. So yes, there was the anti-Semitic boycott campaign against Jewish people by the Nazis in the 1930s, and they should be ashamed of that, and they should make sure that it never happens again. That's not what BDS is though. So any attempt to play into that, it's aspiration. It's a sign that they can only really resort to these grotesque tactics. And a sign that they're afraid of BDS, because BDS will.
What would you say to people who question whether BDS works? You know, it's been now 19 years since BDS was created. The apartheid is still there, the occupation is still there, the settlements are expanding, the genocide has been ongoing for 1 year almost. So what would you say towards this critique that people say it's not effective? What has it brought us?
Well, yes, those things are all true. And as a matter of fact, there's been this unprecedented escalation of actually the ongoing genocide in Gaza against 2.3 million Palestinians. However, BDS has had tremendous success since it was founded. BDS is still here. The BNC, the coalition, is still here, still doing work every single day. And unfortunately, as a result of the genocide, the successes that BDS has had have grown exponentially since October last year. And look, it's important to also remember that a lot of people don't know about this because it's understandably not reported very widely in Western media. The Israeli economy is collapsing. They're in a panic. It is collapsing. You know, the investment is down by huge margins. A lot of companies are going bust, different companies. A lot of funds have backed away from investing in Israel as a result of BDS pressure. A lot of huge projects have been stopped in Israel as a result of BDS pressure. The biggest ever BDS success came this year when Intel halted construction of a factory in Israel that was a $25 billion investment. $25 billion. It's one of the largest investments ever in Israel economy. That's going down the drain. These companies, that's another thing that I want to remember as well. These companies will never ever admit that, or almost never admit, that it was because of BDS pressure that they didn't know this. But it is, you know, it is. Yes, you know, in a sense, things have only gotten worse since 2005, but I don't think that really changes the equation here. BDS remains the most effective way of being active in solidarity with the struggle for Palestinian liberation for those of us outside of Palestine. And it's only escalating, you know. I am convinced that like this is simply not sustainable. If you look at the numbers in the Israeli economy, the number of companies that are pulling out, universities around the world have divested after student pressure from Israel. Again, goes under the radar for the most part, also because the biggest ones still haven't done it, but I believe that they will, just as they did against apartheid in South Africa. And look, if you I think most people here probably, including myself, are too young to really remember those days. But if you ask anyone who, you know, was an adult in the 70s, early 80s, it was unthinkable that apartheid would end in South Africa, but it didn't. And again, in large part, as a result of this tremendously inspiring and tremendously valuable grassroots solidarity all around the world to boycott apartheid, divest from it, and sanction it. And I think that remains what we have to do today.
Yeah, I actually have a dear friend who will be doing spoken word later today, Anton, and he always tells me that he speaks a lot about the anti-apartheid movement, and he's like, actually, in 20 years, you know, in comparison to the anti-apartheid movement, that's a very short amount of time to be having this many successes, and that indeed these liberation movements are marathons and not sprints, so it takes time to change things. You mentioned Intel as a major success. Another major success was Arfda as well, which was forced to divest from all Israeli banks and Israel's largest weapons manufacturer, Elbit Systems. Could you give us a couple more examples of major BDS victories?
We had Puma, of course, as well. Puma was the key supplier for the Israeli Football Association, the Israeli national team, essentially, which is also the organization that runs football competitions in Israel. And in those competitions, they include teams, clubs based in occupied territory, the West Bank. So Puma was made a BDS target, and it announced, I believe in November or December last year, they announced that they were not going to renew their contract with the IRA. Again, they will never say that the BDS is the reason why they're doing this, but it's crystal clear that it is. It remains on the BDS list because the contract runs until the end of this year. But if they follow through on their promise to not renew the contract, then they will cease being a BDS target. And that's something that's very important to keep in mind as well. There's always, for these companies, there's always an until. You're a BDS target until you do, you know, this or that, which is the demands in case of Maxa, it was about their investments in Israeli banks. They divested from that. It's a little bit still unclear exactly. They're trying a bit of smoke and mirrors, so there's still some investigations ongoing to see exactly what's the status there. But, you know, that's the demands, and if they fall through it, then it could be another target. It's very recent success with CarView as well. This was mainly in the Arab world, so again, not something that most people here would have heard of necessarily. But this is a partner that works with CarView in the Arab world that's essentially dropping just because of its call with Israel. CarView, who you're not aware, not only operates in undefined territory, but it also sends kids to, I guess, soldiers and blind dads that are going to Gaza to commit genocide. And there's also, look, something that we haven't talked about is there's a campaign called for directly by the Palestinian BDS National Committee, but there's also grassroots campaigns that are not initiated by BDS, but they are supported by BDS because the movement recognizes the validity of these campaigns, that they're targeting companies that should be targeted, and that they managed to create a movement around it. McDonald's is an example. McDonald's bottom line is hurting tremendously as a result of grassroots boycotts in several countries that have been supported by the Palestinian BDS. Coca-Cola is another example where disaster is ongoing for Coca-Cola in Bangladesh specifically, but also other countries in Asia. As a result, Coca-Cola and Gambia have a factory in an illegal settlement in the West Bank. So there's so many successes, you know, and like I said, it's important not just to focus on the more appealing ones, because obviously when it's McDonald's, when it's Coca-Cola, people pay more attention, but AXA is a huge provider of financial services, you know. These funds that are pulling from their investments from Israel that are, you know, worth billions of millions of dollars. The Norwegian sovereign fund has done that. So it's important to sort of educate ourselves a little bit and go beyond the surface, so to speak, and make sure that we understand that it's not just the boycotts against the biggest, most well-known brands, the type of stuff that plays really well, you know, on social media. These are very important. There's a symbolism there that's very important, but we have to go beyond that. We have to look at where the money is, what are the companies that are really funding the Israeli regime, because these are the most complicit of all.
And this sort of brings us to the end, but if people are sitting here and they feel empowered or motivated that they see that the BDS works, how would you recommend them to get involved and to take action beyond engaging in the consumer boycotts? What else can we do here?
Well, first of all, we have partners here in Germany more broadly, but us specifically in Berlin, you know, there's a BDS Berlin group that they have on social media, they have a website. Get in touch with them, get active, see what they've been up to. I know that they were very important in the campaign against AXA, which was a years-long campaign. They did tremendously good work there, groups in France as well. Of course, a lot of us here have migrant backgrounds, have roots in different countries, see what's happening there. And this is important that it's all informed by what are the companies, first and foremost, that are the current targets of the BDS movements, which, again, you can find on BDS's Instagram page, on the website. Always look down this first, see if you can get active in any of those campaigns. However, there, you know, it might be that if you're living in a place where none of these companies are already active, you might not really know what to do. Don't let that stop you. See if there is any other companies that are complicit in crimes against Palestinians that are active where you live, and see if there's a movement already ongoing there to target those companies, either because of that or, like I said, because these companies are also guilty of violations elsewhere, and you can sort of build a bridge there and include Palestine as well. There's just so much that you can do. You know, like I said, some of these boycotts that have gathered so much attention lately, like McDonald's and Coca-Cola, they weren't initiated by BDS, but they gathered tremendous grassroots support anyway and earned the recognition and the acknowledgement and the thanks of the Palestinian BDS movement. So see if there's anything there going on. I would just say, always have it in your mind very clear why these companies are being targeted and what could they do that would get them out of a boycott list, you know? Because I think it's always very important to have an until that these companies can do. And there's also very clear whenever anyone asks you, okay, but why are you boycotting them? How are they complicit in Israel's occupation and, you know, violating Palestinian human rights? It's very important that we always have a clear answer to those questions, I think, so that way BDS retains also its credibility as a movement that really targets complicity.
Thanks a lot, Lucas. I think for me, the three takeaways based on what you were saying is, firstly, shockingly to maybe none of us here, is that BDS is not anti-Semitic. Secondly, BDS works. It's worked in previous liberation movements. And thirdly, it takes a long time for us to change things, but in these 19 years, BDS was already able to have several major successes. And I would just like to make one final announcement on how you can get involved in BDS. If we could go to the next slide, please. There is an initiative called the BT3P, and this was an initiative taken on by three activists in Germany. Their legal goal is to nullify the anti-BDS resolution that Lucas was referring to, which was issued in 2019. And their political goal is to counter the anti-Palestinian racism in Germany behind the resolution and the closely intertwined German Staatsräson, which was formulated by Angela Merkel in 2008. So you can scan here. They are definitely not at their goal that they need in order to continue this lawsuit. And this is something really crucial that we can directly support and invest in. So thank you very much, Lucas, for your time today. I appreciate you being here and telling us more about this movement. We will now have time for audience questions and remarks.
To be honest, there's no instance that I'm aware of that bothers me to mind, because usually these companies, you know, they're not doing moral sort of soul searching when they bow to BDS pressure. They do it because it got annoying enough that it's hurting their bottom line, it's bad for business, and so they just make this very strategic decision to go with whatever demand was the BDS demand, you know? So if you look at ATA, for instance, I'm pretty sure that if you look at their portfolio of investments, you're not going to necessarily like what you see, and that goes beyond their operations in Israel and their investment in Israeli banks. No, to be honest, I would be shocked if there is an instance in which that led to a company being targeted by BDS and bowing to pressure led to more a broader reform within that company. Unfortunately, that's not usually the case. But again, BDS has been around for 20 years. There's been countless successes that it has had over the course of those 20 years. So someone who has been with the movement from the beginning might be better positioned to answer this for you and mention an interesting example that I'm not aware of. But yeah, to my knowledge, no, and also to make that a demand would also not be really realistic, because that would mean that, well, companies would have to remain targets forever, because especially when it comes to multinationals, that's unfortunately not how they operate, which is, you know, speaks to a broader issue here about how a world works that goes beyond just imperialism, ethical animism, or capitalism more generally. The examples in the global north are, you know, very few and far between, and the situation is very disappointing, very enraging, really, that it's so hard to get these countries to fulfill their obligation to sanction Israel, and at the bare minimum to impose a military embargo, especially in the United States and in Germany and the UK, like you mentioned. That's a huge challenge. However, there is tons of really positive examples coming from the global south, mostly. So if you look at Colombia, for example. Now, when you talk about weapons, there's not much to speak of, because the crucial weapon suppliers for Israel are the United States. I mean, it's basically the United States. It's a U.S.-Israeli genocide that they were talking about. And then, of course, the United States is here. And then way down, you have the U.K. and you have Germany, who are also tremendously complicit. But the United States is the key here. When you talk about, you know, global South states, there is the options are limited, even if there is a willingness to establish a military embargo, but it's not, you know, some of them just don't do that sort of thing. It's not how to sort of trade with it for at all. Take a look at Colombia, for example. Colombia exported oil to Israel. Oil is a huge element it's a no-brainer here, but you're shocked to hear that oil is huge to run the Israeli economy, and that's, you know, all of those planes and those tanks that are using that they're using to massacre Palestinians, all of those run on fuel. So it's very important to impose energy sanction on Israel, essentially, and to stop oil shipments specifically. Colombia has done that. That was a huge example and sort of like the marquee example of states which are going above and beyond to impose sanctions on Israel. Something that I think is also important to make clear here, which is something that I've been asked before, is what is the difference? When we're talking about sanctions, usually people think about the US sanctioning countries because they don't like that they have a left-wing government or something like that, right? Cuba being the classic example. What's the difference between that and sanctioning Israel? Well, the difference is that the United States, when it does that, and its allies, they are meddling in other countries' internal affairs with absolutely no authority to do so. They have no backing in international law to do this sort of thing. They're doing it because they can, and they're using the, especially United States, their economic might to act as a world police and to really strangle any type of nascent government. A lot of, you know, by and large, they're much democratically elected governments that try to rub the boats in how in the power relations around the world. That's not the case with Israel, because the decisions by the ICJ make it a legal imperative to sanction Israel. It's the complete opposite. It's not that, oh, by the way, countries have the option to sanction Israel. No, they have the obligation not to sustain the status quo in Palestine. And like I explained, that entails obviously a military embargo, because Israel is using weapons to maintain the status quo, but also because they don't differentiate between what's occupied and what's the internationally recognized borders, and to also review all commercial ties. So I just would like to sort of like go on this little tangent here to sort of like, anyone has that question to answer it already. But yes, in conclusion, unfortunately, the examples in the Golden Mars are few and far between, although there has been movement towards the right direction. A very timid movement, a very insufficient movement, but they are starting to hold up some market shipments, to review some of the licenses, export licenses to transfer military equipment to Israel. Insufficient, you know, I'm not going to stand in a wallet here, because that's very far from the bare minimum even. But these are things that were not on the table at all, just a few months ago. And just to go back to apartheid South Africa as well, because it's such a key example to keep in mind, a lot of people don't know, apartheid South Africa was sanctioned by the United States. It was sanctioned by the Ronald Reagan's government, the old government. Congress, I mean, he tried to veto it, so doesn't get any credit. But Congress, you know, Ronald Reagan passed a resolution that imposed comprehensive sanctions on apartheid South Africa in the 1980s. So it can happen, even in the United States, of all places. If we build enough pressure, it can happen. The 2019 resolution isn't worth the paper that is written on, but as I already explained, there's nothing to enforce because it's on the law. You know, it was just a nice symbolic gesture to their friends in Israel that they agree with them that BDS is violent, anti-Semitic, and blah, blah, blah. But it has no power. Of course, it's shameful, and it would be good if they sort of repeal it in whatever sense they can repeal it, when it holds no power. However, the elephant in the room here is that the German domestic intelligence agency is investigating the BDS officially as an extremist movement as of a few months ago. So what that means is that they are in a stage now in which they are collecting evidence, and after they do this formal announcement, there's all sorts of things that they can do to collect evidence. I mean, anything that they want to do, really, like they can surveil people, they can follow people around, they can hack into their communications, they can do whatever they want. And then they're going to decide whether, you know, they are going to classify BDS as an extremist movement and to move to ban it, or if they're going to archive the investigation or, you know, whatever that, the term is there. But yeah, that's on point right now, and if they do decide to classify as an extremist movement, I'm not a legal expert, but then, you know, that's another level completely. The fight becomes a lot more difficult. However, any time that has been tested in court, any time the state or whatever other institution has tried to challenge the right to BDS in the German court, they have failed. They have failed utterly. So that's using hope, you know, because Germany, in a lot of ways, is not a democracy anymore. But the hope here is that there is enough of the vestiges of a democracy left that the constitution, the basics of the constitution, such as the freedom of speech and of political, political speech, but we know that that's going on again. But the basics of freedom of speech, such as campaigning for BDS, will still hold on the German court and will still be protected. Is that going to happen? That's anyone's guess right now. But the fact of the matter is that the BDS is shamefully, an anti-racist organization, is that the peaceful, and that peaceful anti-racist organization is being formally investigated as a extremist movement. So if that happens, then the tools for enforcing it go to another level completely.
I would just like to add something to this very quickly, because we should all be outraged that BDS would be considered extremist, and that there is such a power in the masses that if we all engage and join this movement, that it becomes much more difficult to criminalize. And I would like to share one example from another country that was a huge victory. So in France, there was a French activist who would go to the supermarket and who indicated products that people should boycott. And so, for example, SodaStream, they would put stickers on those companies. And they were fined and they were brought to court. And they actually then ended up suing France in the European Court of Human Rights, and they won against the Republic of France. So this was a huge prestigious case about how activists were able to showcase that not only is BDS not extremist, but it's something that everybody can and should engage in. Well, thank you all for joining today. If you have any more questions, feel free to inform yourself on the BDS website, contact BDS Berlin. So thank you, Lucas, very much for being with us today. Thank you.